fine. Yeah. So hi guys, my name is Ranjith. I work for Radar, and at Radar I basically do product support. So my session title is actually a question: what should be the PID 1 in a container? So I hope after 15 minutes, I actually don't leave you with more questions, but some answers which you can take it forward and build on top of it. Okay, so please raise your hands if you have used Docker containers, or if you're using it for production, or if you have either tested it or started the containers or anything. Yeah, so most of you, right? So this is what I have for you. This is going to be very short. I'll be using the first few slides to drive my main point, and then we will have a demo. So I'll be using a demo to actually show you what problem you could face, and why it's important to have why it is important for you to take control on the PID 1. So we'll be spending a lot of time on the demo, and we'll be switching between the demo and the slides more often. Yeah. So for this session, I will be making use of Docker containers, since that is the most popular right now. So how do we control which process becomes the PID one in a container, right? So you actually do a Docker run, when you do a Docker start, how do you control which process becomes the PID one? So in a Docker file, we actually have two different ways. One is the entry point, the other is the CMD. Now, to make it simple, I will just use only the CMD option. So how do you decide which process becomes the PID one? You actually mention the process which you want to become the PID one by mentioning it with the CMD directive. So there are three different ways how we can use this particular directive. So this is the most popular one, where you actually mention the application in this CMD directive. Yeah. So this is just a PS output from two different containers that are running on the system. And if you look at it, so this is my first container where I'm actually starting the HTTPD process. Here you could see the PID 1 is actually the HTTPD process, and the second container is just in a sample output where your bash is the PID 1, and the top is actually a child of the PID 1. Right. So now if with the help of the PID namespace, multiple containers, the processes which are running in multiple containers can have the same PID numbers. But when you look at from the outside of the container from an host perspective, each process has a unique PID number. So now let's take a look at the demo. So for the demo, I'm going to use a simple Python application. So this particular Python application has some known issues. So this particular example is just taken to highlight the problem. So I'm going to use two containers for that. So the only difference between this is, for the container one, I'm calling my Python application directly, right? And for second container, I'm actually calling a shell script, and within the shell script, I'm actually calling the same Python application. It's just that I'm just going to change which process is going to become. Which process is going to become the PID one, right? So now let's take a look at the demo. And on the extreme right side, you actually see some lines which are being printed out. I will tell you why I have done so now. And in the demo, I'll show you a different container with all these lines properly written. So can you see the fold? What have I written? Yes? Is it good? Yeah. So this is my first container where I'm actually calling the Python application directly. Okay. I'm just going to start the particular container. right? So on my second tab, so this is the same system. So I'm on a second tab, I'm just going to start my second container where I'm just calling the bash script first, and then within the bash script, I'm actually calling the Python application. Right? So now let's try to access the particular application. So we'll use a simple curl command. Yeah, so now you can see that I'm able to connect to the container, and also I'm getting an output saying that this is the hello world. So for the same, I will use the same command, same curl command for my second container also. It's just that it will have a different IP. Yeah, because the application which is running inside the container is the same, so you would see the same output, right? So now let's take a look at the PS output. Let's see how it looks like from a container perspective. Yeah, so this is good because as I said before, I am calling the bash script first, and within the bash script, I'm actually calling the Python source. So now let's go to the first container, and let's do the same thing. Let's look at the PS output. So, do you see a problem here? So this is the same application. It's just that in the first container, this is the first container. I'm calling that particular application directly. In my second container, I'm using a bash script, and then from the bash script, I'm calling the particular process. But now, whenever I try to access this particular application, right? So now I'm just going to show you the PS output again. So do you see an increase in number of different processes, right? So each time when I access my application, I'm getting a different process or an orphan process. So at the same time, for the second container where bash is my PID one, so when I try to access the particular container, right? Actually, I'm not seeing any problems here. But there's one different process. So now, why is different process a problem? So now let's take for example, if you have multiple containers running on your system, the same instance of this of the same container running on your system, and at one point of time when the load of the system goes high, you would have different processes within each container. And what really happens is, so now let's take a look at the PS output of the host system. Okay. Right. So when you take a look at the PS output of the host system, you would actually see the actual PID number which is used by the process which is running inside the container. Right. So here you can see here, right? So this is the actual PID number that is consumed by the process which is running inside the container. So if you have multiple containers running on the host and they all have the same sort of a problem, then you would end up consuming all the PID numbers which are available on the system. Right. So by default, just a second, I'll just clear it up. So by default, on a well operating system or a Fedora, you would actually have 32,768 PID numbers. So at any point of time, you can only have 32 processes or threads, or 32,768 processes or threads. So if you have some container that is actually leaking their orphan processes, and if the processes are not being reaped, you would end up in such a situation where you will not be able to log into the system as well, because to log in a system, it has to fork a new process. But since all the bit space is being used, you will not be able to log into the system. So the only way is to either reboot the system, or if you have some other way to reduce the number of ports which are running. Okay, so this is problem number one. That is process reaping or taking care of your orphan processes. So now if you run the same application on a bare metal system or on a virtual machine, you will not see this problem. Because on a bare metal system, the PID one is actually your systemd or your init. So they actually have a special feature where actually they take care of process reaping. So they actually clear the orphan processes. So this is problem number one. Now what is problem number two? Now let's take a look at it. So now is bash the answer for the problem, right? So bash is not, so when you have bash as the PID one, you are not seeing any orphan processes. So is bash the answer for the problem? The answer is an yes and a no, because S, because it has the feature to reap orphan process. Why it's a no? Let's take a look at it. Right. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to stop this particular container, this bash container. Right. So now what is going to happen is you would see this particular command getting paused for 10 seconds. Okay. See, it is actually paused for 10 seconds. So it is not hung, it is just waiting. So now it has come out. So it is able to stop the container, but it took 10 seconds. So now what is happening in the background? So Docker stop actually sends a sick term. That is, it is asking the container to do a graceful exit, right? But here, it first sends a sick term, it waits for by default 10 seconds, and then it actually sends a sick kill, right? So here, so when the container gets the sick kill, it actually exits very quickly without closing all the stuff. So if you have a DB, DB sort of an application running inside the container, and if you don't handle the signals properly, you would end up having a problem where your data is not consistent, where the data from the cache is not flushed into this file system, right? So now, how do you find what is going wrong here, right? So let's say, for example, I'll start the container again, right? Let's find the process. So the process ID is 3960. So if you look, if you look at the PROC file system for an PID, you actually have a file on a status where actually gives you a lot of information about the process. So here we are just interested about sick catch, right? So sick catch is actually in an hex value. So we will have to convert it into a human readable way. So for that, we actually have a bash script. So now let's take a look at what is happening here. So now the bash script is actually registered only for two signals. One is sig. Yeah, so one is sig int. So sig in is nothing but a control C sort of stuff. And then you would see why bash is able to reap the child process, because it actually also listens to sig child. So since the bash has this particular feature to reap, so you are actually able to find it using the sig child. So now is bash the answer for the problem? Okay, is bash the answer for the problem? So we actually know bash is able to reap the child process, but it is not able to handle the signals properly. Okay. So now, do we have a hack? So can we use bash as the answer for the question, what should be the PID one in a container? So the answer is yes, you could use it, but then you would have to rely more on some sort of a scripts. Yeah. So now let's see how we could do it, right? So how we could make bash even handle this six signals properly. So this is what I said before. So here, if you see, So what we could do is we could actually put the actual application in the background and then register for a signal using a trap. Right? So if you register for a trap and you actually wait for a signal known as int and term, so the moment it gets a term, it actually takes it and it passes the term signal to your child processor and then it exits. So it will do a graceful exit. So bash can be an answer for the problem. Yeah, but do we have a better answer? Like what should be the PID one in a container? So you've seen this? Yeah. So as I said before, if you run the same application on a host system, it is actually taken care because your PID one is actually a system. It actually passes the signals properly. It can also read the child processes. So now, what about having a systemd or a minimal init inside a container? So now, to solve these problems with process reaping as well as with signal handling, we actually had, it is still there, we actually have a couple of open source implementation known as a tiny and dump init. So this particular tiny or dump init is so small that it will only deal with two things, that is process reaping and signal handling. So it comes around 128 KB. So you could have this particular binary in your container directory, and then you can actually call it using this particular way. This is how you do it. So you actually use it in your CMD directive, either tiny or dump in it, and then your actual application. So when you start that particular container, So this is how the tree would be. Your dump init becomes the PID one, and your Python application becomes the child of it. So this particular minimal init, they can actually handle two things properly. That is orphan process reaping and handling of signals. So now there's a thing that has come in with Docker 1.13 known as the init flag. So now this particular flag is actually a daemon option as well as you can actually pass it with the Docker run command. So what it does is, so the moment you start a container using a Docker init, right? So now let's go to the demo. So this system actually has a Docker 1.13.1. So I'm just starting the container. The only difference here is I'm just adding this particular new flag. Right? I'm actually adding the new flag known as init. Yeah, so let's see what happens here. See, what is happening is I'm using the same container, but since I've used the flag init, so what the Docker daemon does is it actually starts a minimal init. So that is what you see here, dev init. And then it starts the Python application as a child of it. Right? So now this could be a very good answer for the problem. Like how do you, so let's say if you're not the author of an application which you want to migrate to a container and you actually don't know how it behaves. So this could be a very easy way to do it. That is, with Docker 1.13, you can actually pass it as a daemon flag so that every container that starts will have the PID one as a minimal init. Or you could control it per container by starting it with Docker run, by using it with Docker run. So we actually saw a minimal init. Then we actually saw this Docker init. Then what about having systemd inside the container? So for some of us, yes, systemd could be heavy, but then there are some additional features which you get when you have systemd inside the container. So now with the latest version of Docker, you can actually have systemd running inside a container without using the privileged mode. So this is actually done with the help of OCI hooks. So now what are the additional benefits? So now we actually saw that you can actually deal the problem with signal handling as well as child reaping using minimal inits. But then why do you want to use systemd? So this systemd actually comes with some additional features, which I think you should consider it. For example, let's say, for example, you're actually migrating an application that actually writes its log to the dev logs, or the particular log is captured by your daemons which are running in the host system. So if you're planning to migrate, you know, any application to a container, right? So then what you'd have to do is you actually end up writing the logs either to the STD out or to the STD other. And there are multiple ways also. By using log4j, you can actually send the logs to a remote system also. Yeah, so it actually differs. But you know, but when you actually moving an application from a bare metal to a container, so things should be easy for you, right? So this is where the systemd actually helps you out. So now let's take a look at it. Yeah, so I'm just starting a container, which is actually going to start the systemd. So now let's take a look at the output. So here you could see, so the bin init is actually your systemd. Right. So now what else? So what is the additional benefit that you're going to get? So with the help of OCI hooks, the moment So the moment when you start your container, and your container, so if you see here, right, so here you're actually telling it to be SBIN in it. So if it is a Fedora 25 or CentOS 7, SBIN in it is actually your systemd. So when you start a container, the moment you start the container, and if the Docker daemon, with the help of the OCI hooks, it actually detects your PID 1 is actually your systemd, then it does some additional things. For example, it actually registers your container with the machine CTL. Let me just clear them. Right, it'll take 10 seconds for each container because. Yeah, so here you can see, so right now I only have only one container which is running, and that particular container, the PID one is actually used by a systemd. So now what I could do is, I could check for the logs of the container by running this particular command within the host system itself, right? So now whatever is the output that the your application size, that can be captured here using the journal CTL. Now, for example, let's say you actually use a very simple application like Logger. So the Logger, what it does is it actually writes the logs to the dev logs, and you can actually capture that on your host system. So now if I run this journal CTL command again, you're right. So this actually is a very good benefit if you're just migrating your application, which was actually running very well in your bare metal system, to a container. Yeah. So I'll just open it up for questions. Please hear.
So I realize this might be the first question, but I understand why this is a general purpose programming language, so why did you have to say child prefer to
Yeah, you could do it. But then what you're actually doing is you're actually migrating an application which works very well on a bare metal system to a container. Right? Now, if you actually want to handle these things, you actually end up writing more. You actually make more changes to your application. So now let's say if the same application is running on your bare metal system, you actually need not do anything else. So if you're not the author, I'm saying if you're not the author of the application, it actually... Yeah, so as I said before, I've used this particular... That's what I'm saying, right? If you have an application bug and if you let that particular application bug to run inside a container without you knowing what is happening, and you would come to know about the problem only at the last minute when you have multiple containers running, all those containers are actually leaking process IDs, you would end up having this problem. So now how do we handle these things in a better way? So you could have a minimal init as a paid one, so that you actually have some, a confirmed way that application bugs can be handled.
So you're saying I have one problem, I have an application using zombies. Let's replace it with two problems. I have an application using zombies, and now I have a init deal with my zombie. That's what you're saying.
Because what will happen was, for example, how I came across this myself was. One of my customers was using Tomcat within a container, right? And all of a sudden, just days before the actual production rollout, we actually noticed this problem. So that particular application was running perfectly fine outside. It wasn't creating any zombie. Even if you run this application outside, because it wasn't creating any zombie, because we never knew what was happening, whether it's an application bug or not. So this can be captured at the time of testing, but unfortunately, we actually found this at the last minute. So we actually had to tweak around. So that is how I came across this particular topic, what should be the PID one in a container. Yeah, so your questions are very valid, but then... Yeah. Any other questions? We just have 1 minute. So if it is just one container, that's fine. Let's say if you're using like hundreds of containers of the same instance, at one point of time it becomes a problem. Right, then it depends. So then you have to choose the right orchestration tool. Then you have to use container native storages. Right, so it is not that easy for you. If you have one container, you can use the host mount volume, host mount options. If you have thousands of containers, and this container can run on any nodes, so you have to make sure that particular host mount is there in all the nodes. So instead of using host mount, then you would start looking at NFS or Gluster or the container native storage, which is the popular Gluster. Right. It becomes a little bit top problem, but you can do it. You can actually do a volume. From the host system, you actually send it to your central server. That is your ALK stack, or maybe if you can, you can also use the Splunk. You can actually send the logs from the systemd to the Splunk server, to a remote server. So when it comes to Docker logging or container logging, you wouldn't keep it on your one particular host, because you actually don't know how whether the host will go down or not. So you actually want the logs up. So you actually send the logs to a remote server. So I think we are done.
Yeah.
So thank you for your time. Hope it was helpful.